Good afternoon, everyone. We're not yet close to evening. It's very nice to be here in Hyderabad. And I'm delighted to be in conversation with this year's Srinivas Raipurul awardee, Prashant. And it's actually serendipitous that he's done a certain amount of sort of work on cinema. And I'm excited to have this conversation.
Yeah, I mean, it was very interesting that two people who have actually won a prize in poetry are here talking about cinema, and both of them have interests in cinema, and there is this sort of connection which was really a bit accidental, but also a happy coincidence that has happened, and I'm really excited to see where we take this.
So, Prashant, I wanted to start with asking this question. When we look at the history of early Hindi cinema, we have a lot of writers from the Progressive Writers Association who later become lyricists and even script writers sometimes for Hindi film. And that's one of the ways in which we can look at the intersection of poetry and cinema in the Indian context. How would you respond to that?
I think this is how we have always sort of understood the relationship between poetry and cinema, especially in the Indian context and especially in the context of Indian popular film, because our association with Indian cinema also is always an integral part of that association is with songs.
Mm-hmm.
And songs have been such a sort of integral part of our film idiom that we always think that poetry in cinema lies in that space of music and song and design. And because, as you said, a lot of writers were very actively working in the film industry in the early years of cinema, especially in the 50s, when the progressive writers' movements kicked in. People like Gulzar, Sahir Ludhianvi, Majroo Sultanpuri, Kaifi Azmi. However, one of the things that we must also, I think, underline is that while there were poets contributing their words to cinema, I feel like another dimension of poetry was being also created,
mm-hmm.
which was the poetry which was created on screen,
mm-hmm.
by the directors, cinematographers, editors, who were trying to create a poetic experience,
mm-hmm.
in the language or the medium of cinema.
Right.
Whereas words were, of course, poetic openings for these kind of explorations,
mm-hmm.
I feel that equal amount of poetry was happening on screen,
mm-hmm.
without words.
Right.
If you look at the sort of 1950s films of Bimal Roy or like Madhumati,
mm-hmm.
or a Gurudutt film like Pyasa, or even Raj Kapoor's films, the play of light and shadow, for instance, the way they write with light,
mm-hmm.
almost, you know, it was, mm-hmm. almost like they were writing on screen with light,
mm-hmm.
and creating motifs,
mm-hmm.
figurations,
right.
metaphorical images, symbolic images sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that sort of, I feel that's where it's very interesting to think about cinema and poetry as to how cinema creates a poetic experience using the very specific formal tools that is specific to it.
Right.
Image composition, editing, the light design, set design. Yeah.
Yeah. So cinema as a language,
yeah.
Just like poetry,
yeah.
is a language. But in poetry, the components of the language become words.
Yes.
And, you know, words being operative in the syntax, you know, the syntax,
yes.
which is the arrangement of words on the page, and how, and how that arrangement eventually affects the reader,
yeah.
and the experience of reading.
Yeah.
Whereas what's operative in cinema is the language of filmmaking,
yes.
and how shots are arranged in certain ways, the juxtaposition,
yeah.
of, of that kind of language of cinema.
Yeah, yeah.
Apart from, as you pointed out,
yeah.
figurations, you know,
yeah, yeah.
Motifs and images,
yes.
that are also constructed using that kind of language.
Yes.
I was thinking of, you know, verbs such as looking, seeing, gaze, vision, even you know, a noun like darshan, right? Which I think in some ways are you know, are shared by both poetry and cinema, although they're doing very different, maybe not very different things, yeah, but doing things with very different material,
yes,
so to speak. Because I think that in some ways, you know, scholars have said that the way in which human beings have constructed knowledge and discourses, the metaphor of sight seems to dominate the way in which we try to see the world around us or know the world around us. I mean, when we've seen something,
we
recognize it as something that is true, a true experience.
I think it's interesting in a way that how poetry makes us see things and how cinema makes us see things. Mm-hmm. There's one crucial difference when we think of the language of poetry and the language of cinema. One is that poetry is a verbal medium using words, mm-hmm, and I think what is what is something very special to poetry is that words have a quality of evoking images which are, mm-hmm, not definite. Mm-hmm. So if a word like tree comes, different people will imagine a different kind of tree perhaps in their, mm-hmm, heads. So the image is not a particular image. Mm-hmm. But in cinema, if you look at a tree, it has a certain specificity.
Yeah.
So the so the filmmaker has to work up with other forms of layering to sort of create a sort of a surplus,
right,
in that image, rather, right, than just say that this is just an information of the tree,
mm-hmm,
but to create a meaning beyond just the literal meaning of the tree.
Right.
So image, we say that poetry, a good poetry contains a lot of beautiful images, mm-hmm, but those images are beautiful also because they are also partly imagined,
mm-hmm,
or the words suggest images,
mm-hmm,
and in cinema, however, the images are the starting point,
right,
from where further suggestions are made,
right,
about, and I think that's why in cinema it's not just a singular image which means something,
mm-hmm,
because it's also a sort of narrative art or sequential art. It's also when two images come together,
right,
and the sort of interplay between the images which happens, and I think that happens in poetry too.
Mm-hmm.
It's only when two words come together will a sentence be formed, but also in poetry what you do is there are these line breaks, there are these very deliberate breaks which is, mm-hmm, not there in prose, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
So these breaks allow for certain intervals where new kind of meaning or excitement or,
mm-hmm,
some sort of revelation will happen,
mm-hmm,
not by what is present but, mm-hmm, what is sort of imagined.
Yeah. So I was also thinking of you know, the distinction between the media of poetry and cinema, again going back to, you know, words and images. Perhaps we can say that, you know, the history of cinema is much younger than the history of poetry, but in cinema the narrative form seems to dominate.
Yes.
As opposed to, you know, in poetry we do have narrative poems, we have poems that emphasize action in a certain way, but that is not the only sort of, you know, poetry can also merely be the expression of a feeling,
yeah,
or, you know, an experience of something, of a situation. So I was just, you know, reading this interview from 1953, when a very similar discussion was happening between the playwright Arthur Miller, the poet Dylan Thomas, and the avant-garde filmmaker Maya Deren. And she makes this distinction between poetry and cinema. She says, poetry makes a vertical attack on experience, which is that it's trying to look at the moment and the experience of the moment, what it actually feels like, rather than what that experience exactly is, right? Whereas cinema is more focused on the horizontal attack, which is what happens after this, and then, you know, uske baad kya, you know, that kind of thing. That there's a kind of movement of plot, a movement of narrative. But that said, of course, as you pointed out, there can be the evolution of the poetic form even within even within cinema.
I think actually Maya Deren herself is a good example of somebody who was consciously trying to get away from the causality of cinema, that you know,
right.
just to say that, I mean, cinema is not just an unraveling of plot. It also can have those vertical depths, I mean, mm-hmm. almost, that, you know, in each moment in cinema can have, not just, the moment exists not just to tell you the story,
right.
but also to put you in a place, to put you in a mood, create an experience which is a felt experience, mm-hmm. which is a sort of a emotional mm-hmm. experience.
Right.
Even perhaps an intellectual experience mm-hmm. in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
And many filmmakers aspire for that quality.
Absolutely.
And sometimes they do it by sticking to the plot, I mean, in the sense that they're still telling a story, but the manner in which they tell the story, they sort of are not, obsessed about moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
They're also obsessed, they're also interested in pausing,
mm-hmm.
reflecting deeper. And then there are other filmmakers who completely give away plot
mm-hmm.
to arrive at something which poetry does very effortlessly, which is to say that a sort of a random association of thoughts and ideas
mm-hmm.
which flow into one another and sort of create a canvas of sorts. That's the time I feel filmmakers are very consciously trying to
mm-hmm.
arrive at an experience which is not just narrative.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if this is a good time for me to read that quote from Tarkovsky. The Russian filmmaker Andrei Tarkovsky, who made films under great duress during the Soviet regime, because you know there was so much control over what kinds of assistance he could have, what kind of scripts he could do, where he could shoot, where he could not shoot, etc. So he gave an interview in the French newspaper Le Monde in 1983, in which he, Prashant was talking previously about image. So in which he's talking about the difference between image and symbol in cinema. So he says, I prefer to express myself metaphorically. Let me stress, metaphorically, not symbolically. A symbol contains within itself a definite meaning, certain intellectual formula, while metaphor is an image possessing the same distinguishing features as the world it represents. An image as opposed to a symbol is indefinite in meaning. One cannot speak of the infinite world by applying tools that are definite and finite. We can analyze the formula that constitutes a symbol, while metaphor is a being within itself. It's a monomial. It falls apart at any attempt of touching it. So he's, I guess, establishing very clearly that he's on the side of the image and not on the side of symbol. Symbol, of course, also has a very long and illustrious history in poetry, you know, especially with the symbolist movement and in the latter part of the 19th century in Europe. And then the influence it had on modern poetry in many different parts of the world. But I think that, the point Tarkovsky is making here with respect to film is that he really does not want to collaborate with pre-given narratives or pre-given master narratives, right? Which is something that alluding to a symbol puts him in danger of doing. Whether it is Christian symbols, religious symbols or any other cultural symbols. He wants to achieve figuration, or he wants to configure, images in cinema that are entirely original, not merely because he wants to be original, but largely because he wants, both as a filmmaker, he wants to excavate new meaning, and he also wants the audience to excavate that new meaning and experience along with him.
Clips from I just was thinking when you were saying that actually is at the essence of any artistic work, but more so a poetic work, mm-hmm. which is to say that a sort of restlessness or a defiance of a prescribed meaning of a word or an image.
Absolutely.
In the sense that that's the difference between, say, reading a work of literature or poetry and reading a newspaper, where the mm-hmm. words mean what they are largely. Mm-hmm. But in poetry, language is always in the mode of, as you said, sort of a figurative language.
Mm-hmm.
It's always
figurative.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So these figures of speech, literary devices, where language is molded to sort of arrive at something more than the literal.
Mm-hmm.
Or sometimes when you are keeping the language literal, but the arrangement of ideas or arrangement of thoughts are in such a way that it again surpasses that literality. Mm-hmm. It says that this is what I'm trying to, there's a description, but it is not just the description. There's mm-hmm. always a slight bit of a moment of trespassing
mm-hmm.
the prescribed meaning of things.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when cinema does it, and I think cinema will not be able to do it if it's only trying to illustrate, say, the plot.
Right.
It arrives at that moment of more than just information, of the image providing you just information of what happened,
mm-hmm.
but also how it happened,
mm-hmm.
what does that happening make you feel, and
yeah.
What does it trigger, what does it suggest, the
mm-hmm.
suggestiveness of images and words.
Mm-hmm.
That's when cinema becomes really poetic.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the best examples is, of course, Tarkovsky's own films.
Mm-hmm.
So we thought.
We'll just screen a short clip from the film Solaris, which was a science fiction film that Tarkovsky made. This is the opening sequence right after the credits.
Thank you.
Actually, some of the motifs in this scene run parallel to what happens in the rest of the film, especially the water and the green of Earth, because you know he will soon leave Earth and go to live in a space station on another planet, which is surrounded by an ocean, which actually relays, you know, communicates with the human beings on the space station. So, you know, the kind, you know, I think what this scene, at least to me, I think it expresses a lot of things. I don't think it's possible to completely interpret it, but to me, it also expresses the sense of home that the character feels on Earth. The fact that he's so embedded in that surrounding, you know, with the sunlight and the trees and the water, it's all, you know, it's a part of who he is. It's a part of his existence almost, and that is you know, that unity is shorn apart when he actually goes to the space station. So I guess, you know, Tarkovsky, I think, is able to express that without actually saying anything, merely through, you know, creating images in a certain way.
Yeah, and also again, like, it's because we have seen the rest of the film that we can arrive at this conclusion at this point. But when we are encountering it for the first time, it's merely an evocation of a place, sort of a space. But also, I think more importantly, it sort of sets up the way this film is going to look at things, the kind of perspective that it'll have, the sort of stillness of it, the sort of focalization that it does on the reeds, I mean, on the water, on the water, and the sort of it automatically also sets up a rhythm. I feel, and that, you know, it's very interesting that even poetry, often when you write the first line, you have a certain sort of a meter, and those who write completely in meter, they first write the first line, and then you're stuck with that sort of meter almost, like if you're going to write. And the filmmaker also needs to arrive at a certain rhythm, a certain pace of the film. Every film moves at a different pace, at a different rhythm. And the sequence of images that you see is the, and since it's the opening sequence, that's the thing which will set the rhythm of the film. And because poetry and cinema are sequential arts, I mean, things happen from beginning to end in some way. This rhythm becomes a very crucial part of experiencing art in both these forms. And I think that's something that this scene also does. Apart from, of course, being the setting up the motifs which will reoccur and sort of drive the film forward, it also sets up a mood into which you can, you know, which it situates you in that mood.
Yes.
And that's also something which poetry essentially does. I mean,
I was thinking of just slightly moving to, you know, the context of poetry a bit, and especially since we spoke a lot about the image and, you know, the difference between image and symbol with respect to cinema. In poetry, apart from the fact that, you know, words go on to create images or symbols, words are also just words. There is this, you know, book that I'm reading now by the German writer Franz Fuhrmann. The translation of his book is At the Burning Abyss. The experience of the Georg Trakl poem. So he writes almost half the book sort of analyzing one poem and reflecting on it in order to understand his own experience of the Second World War, of, you know, having been through, you know, the Nazi regime, and also of having worked as a soldier and experienced the defeat of the Nazis, and then having had to move on from a, you know, staunch faith in Nazism to being, you know, a socialist, a communist. So he actually makes a very insightful distinction between two usages of the word word in German. Pardon me if I'm getting a little arcane here. So in German, you have, you know, the word for word is Wort, but the same word can have two different plural meanings. One plural is, Wörter, and the other plural is Worte. So there are two different plurals indicating that there are two different meanings of the word word in German. The first meaning indicates, the classificatory aspect of words, which is that, you know, they name objects in the world, they name things in the world, and they allow us to distinguish between different aspects of reality. And they also allow us to discover things in reality. You know, when you say a chair, you know that you'll, you know, because you've learned to name a chair as a chair, you can find a chair in the world. The other kind of word, in German at least, refers to the aspect of saying, or, for instance, the word of God, or, you know, the biblical word, or the word exchanged, when vows are, taken, or even, the words that are sort of enunciated in a courtroom, during a judgment. Those words are obviously doing much more. They are actually making something happen. There's a different kind of quality to those words. They are performative. They're also it's almost as if they are trying to sing something into existence just merely through the fact of saying them, right? So he says that Trakl, moves very far away from the first kind of word, the classificatory and scientific kind of word, which dominates most of our discourses because, we live largely within a scientific paradigm, even though there are many other kinds of paradigms that intrude upon us. He moves far away from it, and he says that, that word in Trakl refers to poetic language, the saying of poetic language, whose essence is the contradictory unity of human experience. So when, say, for instance, an image comes up in Trakl, and maybe I can read a poem after some time. When an image comes up, putting an image in a poem there, he's not merely referring to a thing in the world. He's also obviously referring to some kind of an experience of life itself through the movement of those images. So I'll just read out this poem, the very poem that Franz Fuhrmann actually is obsessed with, in the book, of course, for half a book, but in his life, maybe for 20, 30 years, he's obsessed with, that poem. It's called Downfall. And the translation is by Isabel Fargo Cole. Over the white pond, the wild birds have taken flight. In the evening, an icy wind blows from our stars. Over our graves, the night bends its broken brow. Under oak trees, we sway on a silver barge. The city's white walls ring forever under vaults of thorns. Oh, my brother, we blind clock hands climb towards midnight. Okay. I think, all of these images of the white pond and the wild birds, the evening, the wind, the graves, oak trees, night, all of these are, I don't even think that they are metaphors. They are really just what they are, but they're simultaneously much more than these, very presences in the natural world. And I think he's trying to, in some ways announce, you know, the experience of downfall. Of course, Trakl is writing this right at, in 1913, before the First World War starts in Europe. And he's sort of perhaps prophesizing or announcing a certain, experience, historical experience, if you may. But he's obviously not doing it with a certain kind of knowledge that, you know, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to write a poem about the historical moment now. It's almost as if, his experience of time is translated into that poem, and that poem is not only able to offer us some insight into, the First World War or the experience of the First World War, but for Franz Fuhrmann, also an insight into the experience of the Second World War. So, you know, there's sort of, the poem is charged with the presence of many different times in it, almost.
Prashant? Yeah, I mean, when you were reading this poem, the poems that I wanted to read today also seemed very much in conversation, because I'm reading the poems of a medieval or like late medieval Sufi from Kutch called Shah Latif, and his poetry puts me in a very interesting place where what he's saying often are very short, terse observations, very crisp images, and often they are very literal. That, you know, we see is a crow flying, something landing, mm-hmm. as you know, in this poem. But of course, they seem to suggest, because of perhaps how little they give away, mm-hmm. they seem to suggest something grander than that. Mm-hmm. And of course, the interpretations of Shah Latif go on at different levels, including to the point where everything that he says is given a religious or a spiritual sort of connotation, and that might be even true, but there is also delight in just relishing in the skin of the word almost, mm-hmm. like, you know, in the sense, as you said, that how are these words able to provoke in us certain images, but also certain emotions, certain like ideas, or when we, I mean, that's another thing which I'm very fascinated by these days, which is to say that when we say that we are moved by a poem or when we are moved by a film, I feel like it's a very literal movement in the body. You know, sometimes we feel a pit, there is a sort of a emptiness in our stomach, our heart starts racing. So certain sort of movement happens, and I feel Shah Latif creates that sort of a moving experience by sometimes literally focusing our attention on something. And that's something which poetry does, and I was listening to it, and that's also something, just by focusing on particular details, mm-hmm. The experience that is created could be of loss, of downfall, or mm-hmm. so there is one poem that I can read from Shah Latif, which is from a verse from Sur Karayal, which is, he wrote this section is called Surs. So it's a little thing which says, night fell, the peacocks gathered, they lunged for the snakes, killing them in great numbers, they drank down their poison. The snakes and the peacocks are locked in mortal battle. Who will retreat? This is the decisive moment. So, I mean, it's, and then, like, for instance, there's another short thing which says, crows descend, a cawing clamor fills the world. Sensing the changing wind, they left. The swans flew away to distant lands. So it's just a evocation of something very particular, almost scenic. But there is, I feel, there is a sensation that something else is happening.
Yeah, some kind of, I hesitate to use the word order, but some kind of a movement in the cosmos.
Yeah.
And so there's an indication of not just the particular, but then also some kind of, there's a pointing towards something that's outside that holds these particulars. And
And it happens a lot in mystic poetry, for instance, because mystic poetry often talks about things which are outside of the, I mean, there's a certain transcendental quality to them, and yet the form that they're using is very form, I mean, in the sense that there are words, grounded. Very grounded.
So, you know, maybe we can refer back to that Kabir couplet that we were talking about. So, the very famous one, Bhala hua meri gagri tooti re, main to paniya bharan se chhooti re. Right?
It's great that my pot has broken. Now I am relieved of the duty of bearing water from the well.
Right. So in you know, in this couplet, is the pot just a pot, or is it more than a pot? Is it an image? Is it a symbol? Is it a word? Right. So.
Yeah, I mean, this is something which I keep battling with. I mean, I also sometimes teach mystic poetry, and this is, I feel that nowadays we live in a world where we love decoding symbols, because I think we're surrounded by so many symbols that now our excitement is coming out of how well we can, you know, get it, how we can, how well we can crack it.
Right.
So immediately when I read some of Kabir's poems, which are often this sort of mystic, I mean, in the sense that odd situations, you know, like somebody's pot has broken, and she's like, wow, amazing, like, you know, my pot is broken, I'm relieved of this duty. So students immediately want to not live in this amusement, but to say that, so what does the pot suggest? Mm-hmm. Is this our body? Is our body broken and the soul? I say, like, sure, I mean, that could be the mystical reading of it, sure, spirit. But there's also delight in the fact of the kind of a silly, amusing experience that the word has created for you. Look at the, I mean, we can for a little while stay at the image and the metaphor that this thing has created and relish in that. Like, I mean, there's another very famous Kabir poem which says, Kabira khada bazaar mein liye lukati haath, jo ghar jaade apna chale hamare saath. It means, Kabir stands in the marketplace, a flaming torch in hand. If you can burn your house down, come and join my band. Now it's a very stark sort of a thing where Kabir is asking you to burn your house down and come walk with me. Now immediately when we say this, so again the question is, oh, maybe he's talking about the ego, maybe he's talking about security, maybe he's talking about comfort, you know, give up your comfort. All of that is true, but I sometimes say, imagine this happening in a film. Where you have to go literally in an image, like you have to literally go and burn your house down and then only walk. And you know, will you be able to do that? Like, I mean, so poetry, I feel like we are stunting the power of poetry by trying to say that everything is symbolic.
Right. So, yeah, absolutely. I think that, you know, in the pot couplet, the pot is actually, for me at least, it is just a pot. But at the same time, in its being just a pot, it's also something more than it. It's actually the very materiality of the pot that allows Kabir to talk about something more than the pot. So the tension is really between the literal and the metaphorical.
Yes.
And Kabir does not choose either. He sort of stays, you know, he stays within that tension. And at the same time that he is, you know, hinting or pointing or indicating towards, you know, the metaphysical aspect.
Yeah.
At the same time, he's very much joined to the earthly and the material. And he's able to do that with, you know, with an image like that. So,
actually, can I just read another poem, which is again, and I want, I mean, when we are here to also look at it, let's say that if this was actually a scene of the film, okay? I mean, it's not just the poetry where, I mean, not just poetry. Poetry is very potent, actually. But I'm saying, let's also sometimes read poetry a little literally. And this is a poem by Shah Latif again. And it says, I am in love with one who carries daggers. I press ahead in the field of love. My head is on the chopping block. Now slaughter me, beloved. I look for the head and can't see the torso. I look for the torso and can't see the head. Hands, wrists and fingers chopped and dropped, who knows where. When oneness is the bride, the groom is cut to pieces. And then there is, I mean, more, but I mean now this is automatically a very violent image. Mm-hmm. And it is describing a romantic experience. Now this sort of confusion, the relief that I think we as readers sometimes immediately say is, oh, it all must be some sort of symbol.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a reason why somebody is evoking this particular feeling of love in these terms.
Mm-hmm.
There's a reason why a camera in a film can go very close or very far.
Mm-hmm.
Each of these choices, I mean, in the hands of good artists,
mm-hmm.
they become really sort of poetic experiences, which simultaneously do two things. One, to make us feel the preciseness of the moment, but also to take us into suggestive dimensions beyond the moment.
Mm-hmm.
And when it happens together, it's like a sort mm-hmm. of revelatory thing, mm-hmm. which sometimes happens with darshan, as
yes.
you sort of said.
Since you spoke about hands, I'm wondering if we should, you know, screen the...
This is Shabnam Virmani and Vipul Rikki. Yeah.
Yeah. So this is just a collage of...
So there is a filmmaker called Robert Bresson, who again was very inspired by Saint Augustine and mystical Christianity. But Robert Bresson was one of those people who used to believe that each shot should not mean a lot of things. It should just evoke a mood, but between shots is when meaning. Yeah, that's it. We'll see how Bresson composes hands.
Thank you.
experimental filmmaker from India called Manikol. He describes his experience of watching a Bresson film and then coming out of the theater and then just looking around and feeling as if suddenly the world has changed, because he was looking at the tree and he's like, I've never seen the tree like this. I've never seen the leaf like this. I've never seen the streetlight like this. I've seen all of this before. And none of these items necessarily featured in a Bresson film. But I think what Bresson's images do is they bring a perspective to life, a way of seeing to life. And once that comes to life, everything around you starts changing, starts shifting. And that's the kind of quality which sometimes figurative language or poetic language also has. Once you see that a word can generate this sort of meaning, this sort of feeling, this kind of configuration, then language itself, or rather the perception of the world or reality itself, starts to feel sort of fuller with possibilities of more things in some ways. And I think that's the kind of thing which we can also connect cinema in, or rather in different ways they do it. Poetry does it by through the power of the word, whereas cinema does it by suggests images which frame something which we are familiar with in an unfamiliar, or in a way that you have not seen before. Or yeah.
Okay. I think since we are running short of time, even though we had some more things to say, maybe we'll just read some poems that you know, connect with this particular theme. I'm going to read a poem by the great German poet Paul Celan. This poem is translated by Michael Hamburger, and it's called Time's Eye. You know, since we were referring to metaphors of seeing, looking, etc. So I'm reading this poem in relation to that. This is time's eye. It squints out from under a seven-hued eyebrow. Its lid is washed clean by fires. Its tear is hot steam. Towards it, the blind star flies and melts at the eyelash that's hotter. It's growing warm in the world, and the dead burgeon and flower. After this, I also wanted to read, you know, a poem by Sridhala Swami, who's not here with us in the festival today. She's written this poem after Abbas Kiarostami, another sort of iconic and great Iranian filmmaker. The title of the poem is Mise en Scène, which is again another cinematic term for putting putting a shot together, or
putting all the elements into the shot. Whatever you see in the shot, the composition, mm-hmm. and all the elements that are present in an image.
Yeah.
The setting of it.
The setting of the scene. So, mise en scène, after Abbas Kiarostami. To set something up and withdraw, so that past the angle of the window, there are trees that throw their shadows on a face, or whip by before one can tell of what kind they are. To see past the face that is talking, to where in the distance a small figure maneuvers a machine, taking time over his work. The armature of the crane takes its time. The earth is shifted in very small increments. We will not see the end of this fashioning. Or to set something up so that there is no inadvertent manipulation, because even to have a landscape shift behind her face is to construct something that might mean anything. to look past the conversation might be to arrive at a place where roots take on a larger significance that no one intended. So, finally, to set up stillness. I want to show a rock from dawn until after the sun has set. When their work is over, the village women will go back home, but they will take a path that does not cross the frame. We will only hear their talk in another language we have never learned, and we might see some light from their lanterns fall across the rock we are observing. We do nothing, like the sunlight itself that we have caught all through the day, as it made the granite hard or dappled with the shadows of leaves, we shine upon this place and on the voices of these women, our brief light, and then we leave.
We have this is the last thing.
Right? Yeah.
Okay, so just to end with another poet, Arun Kolatkar, who's written a wonderful book called Jejuri. It's a series of poems about a place called Jejuri. And he's also somebody who's very evocative. His images are very evocative. But he also subtly shifts the literality of images at the almost often towards the end of the poem into sudden philosophical sort of maneuver. And that's something which is quite beautiful, and I especially like this one which actually Aishwarya picked, but I really love this poem. It's called The Bus. The tarpaulin flaps are buttoned down on the windows of the state transport bus all the way up to Jejuri. A cold wind keeps whipping and slapping a corner of the tarpaulin at your elbow. You look down at the roaring road, you search for signs of daybreak in what little light spills out of the bus. Your own divided face in a pair of glasses on an old man's nose is all the countryside you get to see. You seem to move continually forward towards a destination just beyond the caste mark between his eyebrows. Outside, the sun has risen quietly. It aims through an eyelet in the tarpaulin and shoots at the old man's glasses. A sawed-off sunbeam comes to rest gently at the driver's right temple. The bus seems to change direction. At the end of a bumpy ride, with your own face on either side, when you get off the bus, you don't step inside the old man's head.